live from New York, it's The Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. Today, we're going to hear from Abby Martin, speaking truth to how lobbyists have weaponized transparency. It's a long interview. We're only going to play a short part of it today. We're also going to take you to Skid Row in California. Now, the last time I was in California, it was to raise money for KPFK. I did it by doing a premiere of a film, which was very well attended. And then I did a lecture afterwards. And then I went for a long walk. And in fact, I walked about 6 hours through the streets of downtown Los Angeles. And there were some parts that were a little rougher than others, more modern than the older sections. And only occasionally would I see a homeless person, not with a tent, generally on the streets, panhandling. Today, 80 blocks, one after the other, every square inch is taken by a homeless person with tents, and unfortunately, the city, in its infinite wisdom and bureaucracy, chose not to have any quality of life features like portisans or running water where people could just get something to drink or any provisions at all, food, clothing, nothing. Well, you can imagine that there's a lot of squalor. So we're going to take you there. Now, later on, in about 2 months, I'll be there. In fact, I'm going to take a, I don't know how many people, but I'm buying a used RV, having it, my IT staff fixed up so I can do my portable broadcast and do my filming from there. Yesterday, I filmed in San Francisco. I filmed Dr. Dean Ornish, who was the person 40 years ago who opened the door to showing that you could reverse heart disease by changing your lifestyle. I happen to have been the only journalist there covering it. I was there and filmed it. In a new film on heart disease featuring Dr. Ornish and about 20 other cardiologists using a plant-based diet, I've captured the old film footage and showing what it was like then and how his programs evolved to this day. But in any case, I'm going to have a van that I can do all my film work in, editing, and plus broadcasting. It'll be kind of neat. And I'm going to invite some of the members of this audience who are want to see how documentaries are made. I'm going to be filming three documentaries simultaneously, but one on poverty and the new poverty. The Skid Row in every city is easy to find. What's not easy to find are all the people who are working two jobs and frequently are homeless. The myths about people on welfare being lazy or drug addicts or, you know, welfare queens. Just the opposite is true. You just can't imagine how hard people work, how they suffer, how their children suffer. So I'm going to bring you their story. And all the senior citizens who you never see, who are locked away in apartments or homes, too poor to have a quality of life and frequently lonely. So I'm going to focus on their story. Anyhow, I'm going to play a clip from Skid Row, America's homelessness capital, today. Also today, something you have not heard or seen in any other media, and certainly not on Democracy Now!, because they praised the White Helmets and the, you know, the Assad regime change and the Libyan regime change. We opposed it. Well, what really happened? Remember a few weeks ago I told you that in the next couple of weeks or months, the truth would come out. Well, now there is an international group that has been on the scene, done their examination, and gone to The Hague in the Netherlands. Well, we have a clip from the people testifying who were there, the doctors, a father, a son. By the way, the same son that you see in the White Helmets video, you're going to hear from. So we're going to play you the first to show you the truth. Everything we told you was the truth. everything that the administration, the White House, the CIA, CNN, NBC, all the other pundits told you was not correct. So the truth today, what really happened in Duma, Syria, and then I'm going to have a guest on in the next part of our program, and we're going to talk about some interesting things with my guest, but I'll wait and get to that a little later. She is Cheryl Mitchell, and we're going to talk about what we can learn from the Indigenous American wisdom for a spirit-based activism to foment constructive change with Cheryl Mitchell, an attorney and a Native American. So we have a lot to share today. We always begin our program sharing the latest on health and healing. From the University of Adelaide, and that's in Australia, new research from the university has found that taking vitamin B6 could help people recall their dreams. This was published in the Perceptual and Motor Skills Journal, and they took vitamin B6, a group of people, before going to bed for 5 consecutive days. Quote, our results show that taking vitamin B6 improved people's ability to recall dreams compared to the placebo. And that was from the head of the University School of Psychology. B6 did not affect the vividness or bizarreness or color of their dreams and did not affect other aspects of their sleep. This is the first time that such a study into the effects of vitamin B6 and other B vitamins on dreams has been carried out on a large and diverse group of people. It was a randomized, double-blind, placebo-controlled study. They were taking 240 milligrams of B6 immediately before bed. By the way, that would be the amount I would suggest people with different conditions and certainly PMSing. That makes an enormous relief, but never for sleep. But because they took that amount of B6, they were far more lucid in their dreaming and could remember their dreams. Okay. I mentioned how powerful dark chocolate is. The scientific literature just continues to swell. This is in the University of Incarnate Word in Texas. And it showed that just a few bites of dark chocolate can offer some improvement in vision quality. So that's because the flavanols appear to sharpen eyesight. And that's important. This is published in the Journal of the American Medical Association's Ophthalmology. So my suggestion would be 2 little squares of dark chocolate each day. And make sure you read the ingredients to make sure that it's ideally an organic cacao dark chocolate. If it's sweetened, the most preferential sweetener would be cocoa sugar, organic cocoa, coconut sugar, because that has a low glycemic factor, so it won't spike your blood sugar like other sugars would. From Loma Linda University, they have another article on eating dark chocolate, and it shows that it can improve your life. Scientists are finally confirming what dark chocolate lovers already knew, that it reduces stress and improves mood. And that's important. So they're suggesting 70% made with organic cane sugar. And by the way, let me just explain this because it can be a little confusing. Organic cane sugar should have come from organic cane juice. Now, to try to make sense of this, I went down to the islands, Jamaica, and then Trinidad, and then Barbados, all known for enormous amount of sugar production. Also, I saw this in Cuba. First, it starts off as sugar cane. It grows very fast, very dense. And if you were to go into the cane field, take a machete, whack off, it looks like bamboo. If you didn't know the difference, you probably would mistake it for young bamboo. But it's not as dense. And you taste it, and it has a slight sweetness to it. That's mainly the glucose. You're not getting a high degree of sweetness. So they take a whole batch of this cut cane sugar, and they take it in, and they feed it into a machine that has giant steel claws, one on the bottom, one on the top, these rollers, and as the cane goes through, it crushes the cane. So the juice from inside the cane drips down into trays and then into a larger holding tank, stainless steel holding tank, and the other material goes right out the back, and it's probably got 30% juice still left in it, but they use that then to make cow feed and other feeds. They dry it up and pulverize it, and that becomes an organic form of high-quality fiber, and minerals are also in it. Now, in that dark, and it's a dark syrup, when you look at it, there's all kinds of minerals, and that's a natural sweetener. It's a lot of a low glycemic index. Now, from there, you can use it as a cane syrup, but more often than not, they simply dry it. And when they dry it, it comes in either a powder or a brick. And then people, for example, in Great Britain, they've always liked to have a brick of this, what they call turbinado raw sugar, and they would then cut a piece off and put it in whatever they were using. But today, almost everyone gets it as a powder. And that's where you get your powder from. But up to this point, it's still healthy. It's still has no chemicals, preservatives, no dyes, bleaches, no emulsifiers, no sterilization. It's a raw food. And that's what many manufacturers use to sweeten their products to keep it in the realm of healthy. So when you see the term raw cane sugar, that's what it's at that process. Then it goes further. Beyond that point, it goes from the health market, the health food stores and health products, goes to a more commercial market, and that's the huge market. And for that, people don't want to see something that's brown and has kind of a gritty taste, slightly sweet but still gritty, because if you were eating it just like that, and I did, I just wanted to see what it tastes like, so I took some, and it kind of feels like eating little particles of sand, except it dissolves, but it doesn't have a good mouthfeel, and it is a lot less sweeter than what most people might perceive. But from there, they get rid of all of that fibrous material, in which case they also get rid of the minerals and the vitamins and the enzymes and the phytonutrients, all the wonderful things that photosynthesis allowed to happen inside that cane sugar. Then, what we call sugar cane down there, and then it is bleached with a lye, and then it is sprayed into a gigantic room. Had I not seen this, I wouldn't have believed it. I don't know what the standards are today, but at that time, it was just a concrete floor room that this spray came out the vent, and then they had to go in with a bulldozer with a blade and pick it up and then take it into position another place where it was packaged. And that became the turbinado sugar or brown sugar. In fact, it got so white from all the minerals being taken out of it that they actually add molasses back into it, and that was what was called brown sugar. And that molasses is the only thing that was beneficial, and that's very little, so I wouldn't recommend any of that. Anyhow, that's at least give you a little better definition of what you're dealing with. So now, what we're seeing is that there's a huge amount of science showing you that healthy, organic cacao with a 70% level of cacao is good for your heart, good for your brains, good for your arteries, and is very healthy. Now, another healing food is garlic. There's a study from the University of Nottingham published in Trends in Pharmacological Sciences, the peer-reviewed journal, that agrees that eating garlic, which, by the way, has been used for thousands of years to treat human disease, it used to be crushed into a poultice, and in fact, in the South, they did that. My family came over as, as Quakers. And that's my background. I never talk about all this. One day I'll have my brother on who's far more aware of all of our family tree than I am. He has spent years in deep scholarship, sometimes 20 to 40 hours a week studying this. We go back, he traces back to about the 4th century. In any case, we came over with William Penn and settled what now is the Shenandoah Valley, from Pennsylvania down through Delaware, because of the amount of money that was owed to William Penn, and the king gave him this large amount of land, and he needed people to farm it, and the Huguenots and the Quakers did the farming. That's so my family helped founded the whole agricultural community in the Shenandoah Valley. We were the first there, and mainly were farmers and engineers. And in any case, let's just say that when people were sick, they had different ways of treating it. And these were written down in books and letters, very articulate. You read a letter from someone from the 1800s, 1700s, they had a far better use of words and languages than a college graduate today. But let's say you had a wound. You would cut yourself, a leg wound. You would take garlic and you would crush it down. Then you would take bee propolis, mix the garlic with the bee propolis, and then raw honey, and then you would pack that into the wound. And you would change it each day. And also using apple cider vinegar as a cleanser. That would burn, but boy, would that kill all the bacteria. That saved a lot of people's lives. They would also use that same concoction to take if they had a cold or flu. In any case, everyone now agrees, the scientific literature is more than supportive with thousands of articles, that garlic is one of nature's most perfect foods. And the more you eat, the healthier you're going to be. They just didn't know all the things that make it unique. But overall, what garlic's unique flavor comes from is sulfur. But there are many different sulfur compounds. And the allium family, A-L-L-I-U-M, that's where the plant absorbs sulfate from the soil and incorporates it into an amino acid and sulfur storage molecules. And these sulfur storage molecules can then be broken down into approximately 50 different sulfur-containing compounds when the garlic is prepared and eaten. Quote, these molecules give the plants an ecological advantage when they're growing out in the wild. As it happens, they're also biologically active with mammalian cells and tissues. So garlic is good, and as an organic farmer and as an organic farming teacher, and having, by the way, the first organic teaching farm in New York State, and having taught thousands upon thousands of people from this audience up at the old Fertiller farm, if you noticed, all of the plant rows were bordered by garlic. Shallots, garlic, or onions. Why? Because insects don't like the way they taste. And so they leave them alone. Nasturtiums, pansies also work. But garlic is the superstar. If you want to keep bugs out, garlic. Also, rabbits and deer don't like garlic either. So you let the garlic shoot go up, what's called going to seed, and it flowers. And that flowering is really tasty in a salad. Garlic sprouts are terrific. But that then little tiny spores come off every time the wind blows, and it spreads those spores all over the ground, and that helps protect from predators eating up your plants. Anyhow, these compounds are well studied in garlic, and there's research to suggest they're important to producing the health effects, lowering your blood pressure, lowering your blood sugar, helping your heart. In fact, chopping fresh garlic and fermenting garlic in alcohol and then pressing garlic for oil, those are some examples of how different sulfur compounds are released and have been used throughout history. Well, there's really no right or wrong way to prepare your garlic. It's just that if you lightly heat garlic until it's just translucent, you release far more biological agents. Now, you can juice garlic and do that, but if you're heating it lightly, that's the best way of doing it. And also you're increasing nitric That's NITRIC, nitric oxide, and hydrogen sulfide, which are naturally produced by our bodies. And they play an important role in cell communications, maintaining homeostasis, and altering the levels of them is what we need to increase circulation also. So one more reason to have garlic each day. It makes an enormous difference in our health. We are 20 minutes into our program. I'm Gary Null. On the road, we're going to take a break and come back, and we're going to go directly from the break into the truth the media does not dare share. And when you hear the real people from Ghouta in Syria that we were told in hysterical terms by Fox and by MSNBC and by CNN and all the other media, you know, Assad's bombing once again with sarin gas as citizens, we got to deploy. Right then, it was just a perfect time for John Bolton, the biggest neocon in Washington, D.C., representing the corporate military-industrial complex interest, to say, bomb him. Now, what if Russia, who had already lost 200 of its soldiers by American bombs in the previous short period of time and decided not to retaliate, what if they would have retaliated? Then that could have led to a full-scale World War III. We told you that Assad, from our evidence, we called people that we know, reporters on the ground in Syria, and then there was one of the finest journalists in the world from The Independent in Great Britain went there. He was the first journalist. He found no evidence of sarin gas, no evidence of chlorine gas, evidence that America's bombs had dropped nearby, causing massive amounts of dust that had caused the kids to end up with respiratory distress. So it had nothing to do with Assad. Nothing. Zip. Zero. But Israel was pushing for conflict, and France was pushing conflict, Great Britain was pushing for conflict, and that's what we had. Now you hear the truth when we come back from this simple, maybe 60 seconds break.
So you're heartbroken. You sit around moping, crying, crying. You say you even thinking about dying? Well, before you do anything rash, dig this. Everybody plays the fool sometimes. There's no exception to the rule. Listen, baby, it may be factual, may be cruel. I'm lying. Everybody plays a fool.
Discussing facts, we have patriots of Syria here with us, and it would be the right thing to do to give the floor to the small boy here, Hassan Diab. He's only 11 years old. You can see him on the white helmets footage. He's an alleged victim of the chemical attack. But first, we would like to ask his father, Amar Diab, to say a couple of words. And after that, if Hassan wants to say a few words, he will be given an opportunity to do so. Good evening. My name is Amar Hassan. I'm the father of this little boy you can see here. I'd like to speak about the truth of what happened. My children heard the screams that they needed to go to the hospital, so they went to the hospital. They saw fires in the streets, they saw smoke, so they came to the hospital, to the tunnels near our house. In the hospital, some people took my children and brought them to the ambulance, and they started pouring water on them, cold water. Now, because of that, They have suffered, and my wife explained that these children were brought to this hospital without asking their parents. Later we found out that this was a fake. We saw absolutely no evidence of chemical weapon, and all of my family members are feeling well. We were in the basement and we heard people shouting that we needed to go to the hospital, so when we were in the hospital, we went there through the tunnels. At the hospital, they started pouring water on me. The next participant of our talk today, Khalil Al-Jaysh, a doctor. He's an expert in resuscitation. Good evening. We came here to inform the world on what happened in Douma, because what happened goes against what was shown in the media and spread through the media, because the video you have seen shows the hospital, the emergency rescue department, and I have been there, I have seen what happened, and what happened was not shown on this video, because on the 7th of April I have been in the hospital about 7 p.m. We had people coming in as suffering from asphyxiation, but the fact is it was because of smoke, so they had difficulty breathing because of smoke intoxication, and the reason it happened was because nearby building has been bombed, and there was smoke and dust that came inside into the hospital, into the buildings, and in the shelter where people were hiding, people unfortunately inhaled all this dust and smoke, and this is why they had difficulty breathing. So the symptoms of an asphyxiation were relatively mild, moderate, and we did everything that we were supposed to do. We gave them oxygen masks. We proceeded as we always do in such cases. We gave them hydrocortisone. Then a person came, one of the white helmets, and he started shouting that there was a chemical attack, that chemical weapons have been used. And after that, at the emergency care, we saw people creating this hysteria, this chaos in the hospital. They started dousing people with water. We didn't believe these people because we saw no symptoms of chemical attack, chemical intoxication. So there were no evidence of chemical weapons use. All these things, all the people who had suffered from asphyxiation came home later that day. There were no deaths, no people died during that day. And this is the only emergency care in all of Douma.
Okay, there you have the truth. Real people, the doctor at the hospital, the child that ended up in a white helmet, and the white helmet's trying to create panic and then stage a false flag event, knowing that here they had been defeated. ISIS defeated, al-Nusra, al-Qaeda, all of them defeated. And in fact, Assad had been providing buses. They could take their weapons, their families, and leave, and they had been doing so. There was no earthly or military reason to have created any kind of bomb effort against them. It made no sense, but it made a lot of sense if you wanted to see the Assad retaliated against, demonized. That's the game. Now, we've provided you with the truth. We've had interviews with Ms. Beasley and others who have been there. Why is it with all the resources of CNN, NBC, ABC, New York Times, Washington Post, Boston Globe, Miami Herald, LA Times, none of them have got this right? Not a single one of those journalists have got it right. The person at least did not commit to this stampede of guilt before any proof was provided was Tucker Carlson on Fox. And he's the only one on Fox I would ever trust. Please get him this clip. Send this to Tucker Carlson. See if he'll play it. Because he was right when he told the people on his show, you don't have the evidence and we've been lied to in the past, because there have been others, cases where it was shown by Seymour Hersh, one of the greatest reporters in the world, that we were going to bomb them. Everybody was all pro-bombing. And then it was shown that it wasn't Assad. All of Assad's chemical weapons were decommissioned and taken out of the country. They have none. And when I heard some loon last night on Fox talking about how they're so certain about their positions and no one was there to challenge them, that they're wrong and have been wrong on all of these false flag operations. So please send this to Tucker Carlson. At least you all have heard the truth. And that's what, maybe it's one of the reasons that we have so many millions of people coming to the website, reading the articles, listening to us, because we're not ideological. We're just looking for the truth. Now we're going to play another thing that you're not going to hear in the media, and that is Abby Martin. By the way, we're welcoming Abby because now that she is being censored by YouTube and over 280 sites are being censored by Google and Facebook, we're providing a program for them so the voices of the censored will not be completely silenced. We have a rather substantial audience worldwide. So they're coming over. You'll start hearing them next week. This is Abby Martin speaking with James D'Angelo about how lobbyists, and Washington is full of hundreds of thousands of lobbyists and consultants, weaponized transparency. We'll only play you 5 minutes of it, and we'll save the rest for next week.
So before we get into how transparency has been weaponized, let's talk about how things used to be before 1970. Let's talk about how the president voted, how Congress functioned.
Right. So it's actually a very interesting time. I mean, most people look back at the early 70s as a time of turmoil. There's Vietnam. There's lots of civil rights questions. But mathematically, there's some very interesting things. We are talking the least partisan Congress in American history. We're talking the lowest levels of income inequality in American history. So the rich and the poor are closer than at any time in U.S. history, and some of the lowest in world history. Campaign finances, zero or next to zero. Certainly if we're talking Congress, presidents always had some campaign finance issues going back to the Roosevelts, etc. But for a member of Congress, they're not receiving money to run for Congress in 1970. Throughout history, there have been about 200 floor votes a year. So if you saw the Lincoln movie, that's actually, the entire movie is about a floor vote, which is the final vote. And that vote has always been public. All the committees, however, and all the discussions and in the hearings, all of those votes, so John F. Kennedy, when he was a senator, all those votes were secret. We don't have any record of Kennedy voting in committee. And those votes are upwards of thousands per year. And that's when all the most sensitive work gets done. So there's very few political scholars that would reject the idea that committees are where the work gets done. That's where everything gets done. And then the floor vote is considered, as said by many, the show vote. So you basically already know how you're going to vote. So if you're talking about eliminating special interests, if you're talking about taking on a corporation or et cetera, you're going to do that in committee, where the votes have always been secret, dating straight back to the Constitution, the writing of the Constitution, and even before.
And in 1970, there was something called the Legislative Reorganization Act that fundamentally changed the way Congress functioned and our entire government. Talk about what that was and what it did.
Right. So it's important to realize there's only two legislative reorganization acts in history. There's one in 1946, which scholars have written endlessly on, and then there's one in 1970. And think about the name of that. Legislative means law or lawmaking. Reorganization is we're going to change it act means it's no longer a bill, it was passed into law. So we are going to change how Congress works. Now, notably, again, this is a very important time to change Congress because we're talking about a time when inequality has been dropping for years, incarceration rates have been dropping, and there's no campaign finance spending. And then we change it, and we have this explosion of changes with how Congress is responding to corporate power, etc. The law states a number of things, the most important of which is it says all committees must publish their votes. If you're a lobbyist in 1969, we know exactly where you are. You're in the lobby. Your name fits who you are. If you're a lobbyist after this act, especially by 73 and 75 when they underline this act, you're sitting in the committee. Now they've opened up these tables, and you've got all the lobbyists and all the journalists here, and you're lucky if you've got a couple of constituents in these rooms. So if you're talking about Armed Service Committee, Ways and Means Committees, these are all $1,000 per hour lobbyists sitting there as they're now facing them.
It seems like such an honorable initiative. Let's open up Congress. Let's make all the votes public. Let's finally hold these people accountable. Obviously, we know where it went, but what entities were even pushing for this to happen? And was it kind of, did it have good intentions initially?
Right. So it's always hard to know what's in the hearts of men and who was pushing for it behind the scenes. And the thing, these acts passed overwhelmingly, so 192-6. But we do know certain organizations pushed heavily for this. One is the AFL-CIO was involved. They were excited. They were a very liberal group, and most of the groups that were outwardly pushing for transparency were very liberal, pushing for more civil rights laws or more union protections, etc. And they wanted to make sure that the legislation they were pushing for was passing. The main person pushing for this is a guy named Richard Conlon. Richard Conlon was also a lobbyist. But he knew almost all the congressmen. He was called the 436th member of Congress by a lot of people. And so he would meet him in the elevators, and he would talk to them all about the provisions he was trying to pass, and they would say, oh, we're definitely supporting you, we're definitely supporting you. They'd walk into the committee, then the bill would fail. Mm-hmm. And he'd go, but I counted, you know, 60% of my, you know, the votes were going to come my way. But the votes were flipping on him inside of committee, and so he was very furious about this. And that's exactly what he wanted to do. He wanted to pressure from the outside, as a lobbyist, the way members vote. So these are the two main groups. We don't have civic groups running around with banners, we want more transparency. And certainly at the time, if you look up in what Google, whatever it is that measures word usage, transparency is barely even used, accountability is barely even used. Those things have risen in the 70s and 80s, and some people have suggested they've been initiatives pushed by corporations that were kicked outside of committees. And so these groups that weren't making it in committees were some of the initial transparency proponents.
And so many horrifying trends have taken place since 1970, James, that you outline. I mean, just go over some of them.
Taxes on the wealthy. Up until 1976, the marginal tax rate, so there's effective tax rates, so not statutory tax rates, but what the rich are actually paying, are around 74%. So the wealthy are paying 74%, and it's been high for many years. It certainly went up with World War II. As soon as they opened the Ways and Means Conference Committees and the Finance Committees, which are the committees where the Senate and the House resolve their differences, they opened those at the end of 75. As soon as they opened in 76, the taxes on the wealthy plummet. Boom. In 3 years, it goes down 50%, and it's been flat ever since. And so this is what we see, right? As soon as particular committees get open, the legislation immediately benefits whatever special interests. As we know, the U.S. government was actually on the forefront of environmental legislation. So in the 60s and right up into 71, we were passing very strong environmental bills.
People don't like to hear that Nixon is who created the EPA.
right, exactly. And Congress is very much in support of this, and we are just doing just the most foundational work on the environment, and we were pissing off corporations. They were just furious at this. And then we start to soften. As soon as those doors are open, corporations, oil companies, coal companies, who knows what, automotive companies, are coming into these committees, and all the legislation is softening.
And this is, you know, income inequality skyrocketing, the amount of lobbyists skyrocketing, the amount of money that lobbyists are putting in the system. I mean, it just, the list goes on and on and on. The vast majority of Americans support Medicare for All, or some sort of federally funded healthcare system. The vast majority of Americans support net neutrality. The vast majority of Americans oppose cutting Social Security up to 90%. I mean, the list goes on with that. And these are obviously big examples, right? Yet we see our politicians doing the opposite of every single thing that the will of the people put forward. And there's actually a study that proves this, that shows that in every example of the people's will, it doesn't matter because it's not up to the people, James. Can you talk about what this study is and what it shows?
So you've got Martin Gillens, Benjamin Page come out in 2014. They get, you know, it's an elaborate and beautiful study. They gathered tons of data. I think going back to the 50s, they haven't released their work on the older data. But the recent data shows that if the vast majority of Americans support a policy proposal, or if the vast majority of Americans dislike a policy proposal, that policy proposal has the exact same chance of passing. So what it says is if Americans really like it or if they really hate it, it's still got about a 30% chance of passing. And the opposite is true if we look at elites or special interests. So if elites or special interests really hate a policy proposal, it's really unlikely that proposal is going to pass. And if they really like it, it gets up to about 60% that it's going to pass. So what it's basically saying is it's easier to kill legislation than it is to pass it, but it's also saying that elites have much more, they find much more response to their policy suggestions or policy preferences than the vast majority of Americans. Interestingly, though, this is something that I looked at a while ago and presented in my research. I would say that Gillens and Page's data probably doesn't change over.
Okay, now that was just the beginning of a conversation. It's 24 minutes long. I'll be playing other segments because you see how much we just learned that we would not have known. And so with good intentions, those who wanted to get inside those committees, the lobbyists, to sit at the table with the legislator, to actually write all of our laws. They did that when those rules were changed. They're always behind all these. We will have more from Abby Martin. Now, we're going to take a break. When we come back, we're going to talk with our guest, who is standing by, about what we can learn from Indigenous Americans on the natural spirit-based activism to foment constructive change. We're going up to Maine now and say hello to Sherry, that's S-H-E-R-R-I, Mitchell. She is an attorney specializing in Indigenous people's law, policy, and human rights. She is a medicine woman for a native tribe in Maine. She is the founding director of the Land Peace Foundation, which is an organization dedicated to the preservation of the Indigenous way of life. She has been a longtime advisor to the American Indian Institute's Healing the Future program. And she's currently an advisor to the Indigenous Elders and Medicine People's Council of North and South America. And it's nice to have you with us today, Sherry.
Hi, Gary. It's nice to be with you.
I'd like to begin with addressing the matter of colonization. I just don't hear this discussed. And for the average person who knows little to nothing about Native American culture, this has a destructive activity that perhaps goes back thousands of years. And powerful civilizations would colonize weaker nations or city-states. And there have been many forms of colonization, not necessarily militarized. And today we witness the large multilateral institutions such as the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank engaged in economic colonization through loan programs that keep poor nations strapped to endless debt. And the Native Americans have been long victimized, and are still are, by the West colonizing mindset. And there are many directions we could take to look at the impact white American colonization has had on Native American nations and tribes. And one form of colonization is actually on an unusual ascendancy. Now that Trump is in office, is the colonization of U.S. culture by right-wing nationalist Christianity and the myth of the founding of the U.S. as a new Christian empire. And the fact is that when we think of the great religions of the world, rarely are the traditional paths of indigenous wisdom ever mentioned or included. And this has certainly had a negative impact on the preservation of Native American wisdom in the past. So would you please speak about how Native Americans are still being colonized by the U.S. government and, by extension, the corporate capitalist state? The forum is yours.
Well, I think that colonization is a very important subject matter right now. There's a lot of scholars who say that we live in a post-colonial era, which is blatantly untrue. Of course, Native peoples are still being colonized because our way of life is still being compromised. And the things that we require to be able to live self-determined lives are being denied to us. And one of the things that I think has been true is that the impacts that we've experienced as indigenous peoples are now starting to be experienced by others in the population. So the waters around our territories have been contaminated for a very long time by industry. The soil that we require to be able to grow food has been contaminated. The woodland areas where our sustenance food products live and exist have been damaged. So all of those things have created this sense of dependency on a system that doesn't allow for us to live our way of life. So now we look at how these impacts are leaking out into the commons. We can see that industry is contaminating water all over the world. We're in a, on the brink of a major water crisis with cities around the world, major cities around the world running out of water. And, the companies like Nestle are rapidly sucking the water out of the ground. So I think that the greatest example of colonization, not only for Native peoples who have been on the front lines of these protective stances for the water, but for all people around the world, is the colonization of our water. And so we see the colonization of the commons going on right now. I mean, one of the things that is true about colonization is that it has no endpoint. So colonization continues moving until it runs out of things to consume. And then what it does is it turns around and cannibalizes itself. And so what we're seeing now is those individuals who thought that they were safe because they were part of the settler set, having their way of life be compromised. Their lands are now being taken by eminent domain, not for the public interest, but for the benefit of private industry. Their waterways are being contaminated. Look at what's happened in Flint, Michigan, where they're now required to rely upon bottled water because their water has been contaminated and nothing has been done to change that. I mean, the same is true with our food systems, where if we want to grow our own food, there's all of these regulations against it. Growing your own food and sharing it with your neighbors in many places is now against the law. Being able to sustain yourself in a natural way in relationship with the earth is something that has been under attack for a number of years now, and people are starting to feel the impacts of that. Those are the things that we've been experiencing for a very long time, and the continuation of that is often unnoticed by people because they have been colonized within their minds. That's what we call the reservation of the mind, the inability to see the harms that are being aimed at you through colonization, through this mental colonization that allows you to believe that the government has your best interests at heart, that they're acting on your behalf, when the truth is that the government has not acted on behalf of the majority of the people for a very long time, if ever. And certainly it's the case today where the interests of the individuals, individual lives, the life of the planet is taking a third, fourth, fifth seat to profitability. And so all of those things represent colonization. And one of the things that I think is helping to sustain colonization is the fact that this, as you mentioned, the wisdom traditions of indigenous people has been left out of the discussion connected to the larger wisdom traditions that have been accepted within the general population. And the way of life that's connected to those indigenous wisdom traditions really helps us to understand how we are connected to the rest of life. And so you hear quaint things about a web of life philosophy that really has a much deeper meaning connected to it, which ties into things that science is just beginning to understand about quantum entanglement. And so when you look at that way of life, you look at those wisdom traditions and how it helps people to understand their deep connectivity to every aspect of life. Once that understanding blossoms, people begin to behave differently in relation to life. So long as we continue to believe that we are separated from life, we are going to continue to be operating under the illusion of colonization.
How do we decolonize then? If colonization is a psychological behavior and a way of thinking based upon erroneous and deep-seated beliefs, then the process of decolonizing has to be inner deconstruction of these deep-rooted psychological constructs that have a long conditioning period throughout a culture and even in our education growing up, even our parents, the churches, the temples we attended as children. And what, in your estimation, are the more important mental constructs the average American needs to decolonize and separate from?
Well, I outline a number of these things in my book, Sacred Instructions, Indigenous Wisdom for Living Spirit-Based Change. But just a nutshell version is really looking at what aspects of your life are leading you to think that otherness in any form is a proper way of being. That this idea of separation, the illusion of separation, the illusion of superiority over, of dominance over, of one way being more appropriate than another, that illusion is at the heart of the colonizing mind. That if they can get people to believe that they are somehow elevated over another group, that they are elevated over the rest of life, this idea of man having dominion over the rest of the natural world is an illusion. You know, human beings are simply creatures within the natural world, just like all other creatures, and we're the only ones that are out of step with the natural world at this point in time, and the only ones who are risking this critical danger to the rest of life, including our own. We're suicidal in the way that we behave, and that's because of that illusion of separation and dominance that we've held for so long. And so, you know, looking at the language that we use to define our systems and structures, looking at the language that we use to define our place in the world, understanding how our minds have been twisted by these ideas of superiority and separateness that really keep all of the sickness that we see in the world going. Looking at how we have stopped being the keepers of our brothers and sisters in the world because we believe in this illusion of otherness. And so, in my opinion, this illusion of separation corresponds to what, you know, some of the world religions call original sin. In my opinion, the original sin, the foundation, the linchpin for all of these imbalanced scenarios that have spiraled out has been this illusion of separation, otherness, and entitlement that people have been led to believe is true, when it's simply a fallacy.
Appreciate very much your thoughts. Your book is Sacred Instructions, Indigenous Wisdom for Living Spirit-Based Change, and the website is landpeacefoundation.net. Thank you very much for being on today.
Hi, Gary. Yeah, the website is actually sacredinstructions.life.
Okay, good.
Yeah, so thank you very much for having me.
Sherry Mitchell, my guest. We're out of time, everyone. Thank you for listening. I look forward to sharing more on Monday. Have a nice day.